afternoon. It's 4 p.m. on a Monday, and it's Happy Halloween. To my left is Russell Liu, just back from a trip to Beijing that we will talk about later. We are here to discuss foreign investment in Hawaii. More recently, a very large investment for a mixed-use community and hospitality hotel development on the Kapolei side of Oahu, which we will get into a lot more in depth today. So we're going to ask the first question that I'm going to kind of pose, and we're going to take an analytical look at all this, comparing and contrasting with the wave of Japanese investment in the 1980s that seems so long ago, that had a great impact on our economy, on business and society. And now we're looking at the just beginnings of another force out of East Asia, the Chinese. And they're going to also be building and selling and trying to make a profit, as businesses do all over the world. The first question is, this new investor in town, in Honolulu, can you tell us who they are and where did they come from?
Ray, that's a great question. I'm back from Beijing, and there's a lot of excitement to hear that there is a Chinese company called China Oceanwide. It's actually a subsidiary of a larger, a privately owned company in China, and a very large company. It was actually started in 1985. The chairman is Liu Zhiqiang, very well connected, former party secretary, but really a businessman. He's very well sophisticated because if there's any indication how different it is in Japan, they've already set up their U.S. subsidiary in San Francisco a couple years ago. They've got projects in New York, San Francisco, Los Angeles, many places. And the big splash actually this week was they just plunked out $2.7 billion to acquire Gemworth. It's a mortgage company and insurance company. So they have just announced their big plans to invest $103.4 million in a 514-acre plot to help develop the community in Kapolei, West Kapolei, or Kapolei West.
Yes, so that's the big big acquisition that we're talking about.
That's right.
In 1985, when you think about it, going back in time, that's a year after the Plaza Accords. It's in the middle of Japanese investment and their business forays into Hawaii. Mm-hmm. But that's also, when you think about it, and it seems so long ago, 4 years before Tiananmen Square, when things suddenly came to a stop, a halt.
Uh-huh.
So historically, we would see this Oceanwide company really gearing up in late 90s into the 2000s.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. And just to think about it, I mean, I was in China. I first went into China in the early 2000s, and they were still in bicycles, still in mountain jackets, and it was a different world. And just before the Olympics, I was in Beijing, and they were laying out the streets. And it was incredible. But, you know, we're getting that same effect here where they're coming in putting a lot of money. And the question that I always wonder is, how is this different from the strategy from the Japanese investors? You know, Hawaii, we've been lucky to be the recipient of $11 billion of foreign direct investment by the Japanese. But the question is, how different is it? And I think that's critical because this kind of lays out where and how Hawaii is going to proceed in the future. Will it be hostile to this kind of investment, Ray? What are the strategies? How is it different from the Japanese? And, you know, my initial thought is this, and I'm going to ask you that question, Ray,
okay.
is that, you know, the Japanese were, to some extent, investors of a vertical integration, meaning they invested in all the way down the chain. So, again, the investor is different, and now China Oceanwide, not only they're investing in hotels, but they can help do a plan and develop a master community homes.
Right.
So is that a different strategy than the Japanese investors?
I think that's a very good question. And we already have 30 years of history to look back and where the Japanese came in the 80s and today. And you're correct, in the early days, a lot of the investment were on trophy properties, the hotels, the Azabu Jidosha, the Kokusai Kogi, they've been here before, but a lot of new companies came in, flush with cash. So there are companies that really made a lot of money off of the stock market, and also because of the sudden enormous rise in real estate assets that they mm-hmm. owned in Japan. So they borrowed against that. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the money went into already made properties in Waikiki, like the Hyatts and hotels in Waikiki and on Maui and other places, and joint ventures with mm-hmm. Chris Hemeter. Remember all the Kumagai-gumi engineering construction company did a lot of work for Chris Hemeter's grandiose kind of mega projects. The biggest one was Waikoloa, of course, on the island of Hawaii. And then, but including all those big investments came a, like you say, ecosystem of course, the JALs and ANAs, JT, which are the airlines, and also the JTBs and HIS tourism agencies, the travel agencies. So there was an ecosystem that they developed for the Japanese tourists. Mm-hmm. So you're correct that they came in, but they had to work very closely with hotels and with the staff to have a Japanese-speaking infrastructure in the hotels and the restaurants and so forth that kind of developed, and the duty-free and the particular omiyage or the presents that they like to bring back to Japan. Mm-hmm. So, having said all that, and that was really concentrated in that Waikiki space, mm-hmm. There were other companies like Haseko that mm-hmm. did develop on other parts of the island, very close to the Kapolei, in fact, and other developments on Oahu. So there were construction projects, but you have a very good, interesting point here, because from a Hawaii perspective, and that a lot of the projects needed a market that was not exclusively Japanese, when you think about it. And this project, which involves hundreds of acres, will not be sold to 100% Chinese. Mm-hmm. They have to sell to mm-hmm. a wide range of local, mainland, mm-hmm. and Chinese and Japanese, or whatever, international clientele. So I think this is a integrated project that will really be challenging for any company to really develop the hotels and a marina or all kinds of other areas and the thousands of units that they're going to make. So in retrospect, the Japanese companies came in, they could control an ecosystem, which was Waikiki. Mm-hmm. It's harder to control a basic residential community-based area like in West Oahu.
Well, let me pose another question. I think Haseko is a Japanese developer, very successful, and they've done an excellent job of planning a master community, building homes, and they're in the business of hotel resort development also. So we're seeing the flip side. It's like what Haseko has been doing, building a master plan community, and now probably Chan Oceanwide, learning the lessons, maybe looking at Haseko, saying, well, we can make a master plan community, which would be good for the community. Do you see that some resemblance to that?
Oh, yeah. And in fact, if you go more back in time, I worked for a company called Oceanic Properties, part of Castle & Cook. And back in the 70s and into the 80s, a master plan community that really is a model is Mililani Town. Mm-hmm. And that included the golf course, malls, and all kinds of amenities, and CCNRs, mm-hmm. so that the look and feel of homes were of a pattern, so that you don't get crazy, architectural designs that result in lowering of values for homes in the neighborhood. So there were, I think if you go back in time, there's models of a Castle & Cook that they did very well. But in any kind of master plan community, and I think you're going to agree with me, is that you have to work very well with the homeowners, with the community itself, and their desire for a certain amount of the amenities and what they were promised, what the community looks like, and that the value they paid for their home is continuing, that they would have a home in a neighborhood that retains its value over time.
Mm-hmm. And that's where I get to what I think, as I see, very different than the investment in the 80s by the Japanese. They invested in an area that was really non-residential, except for small areas in the Waikiki areas. Very different, not leasehold land. This is an opportunity where there is no more room for further hotel development. And this whole area, the 514 acres, has been part of zone for residential, for building homes. And in essence, you know, they're helping build a community. And it's going to give a different kind of brand of tourism, you know, with the Atlantis that's going to come up. We're probably going to see high-wealth Chinese who have traveled around the world. And that will bring travelers not only from China, but I see other places from Europe, high wealth that really want this kind of luxury. So it's a very interesting strategy. And the question that I always have is, in my mind, living and working in China, well, people will say many Chinese are short-term investors, but I really think this is a long-term strategy. This is a strategy to evolve, to become more American. And people ask me, being in China, why is it so? And I see the economy is changing in China. You know, the renminbi has got weakened, and it's a great opportunity for a Chinese company flush with cash to go out to diversify its assets. And what other better is in the U.S. economy where the dollar has become stronger? So I think we're the beneficiaries of a good investment coming in. And I think the fact that this investor is also invested in a company called Gemworth in the life insurance mortgage area, it seems that it's going to be a long-term commitment, not a short-term.
So I'm getting out of you that in order to do this project right on the island of Oahu, in the state of Hawaii, it has to be a quality project.
I think so.
They have to have very high standards. They have to work with the best of the best of global architects, designers, and construction firms. And of course, since they're on the first list of getting out of the block, that they would be under much greater scrutiny, right? Mm-hmm. From the media, from residents, and so forth. So they can't do something that will result in a bad reputation. It has to be a very good reputation, ultimately, to sell the homes, and it has to be really great. So if you were looking at it from a global perspective, you know, traveling all over the world and looking at quality developments in residential or resort and so forth, if you were going to advise Chairman Liu, if he was here right now, what would you tell him and you're from Hawaii, you know the intrinsic challenges of real estate development here in Hawaii. It is not a simple task from a lot of mainland people coming here thinking they're going to get a permit in 60 days or construction very cheaply and so forth. But you go back to China, remember they can do anything they want in many cases. And their construction is so fast and they can get things. And they're really great projects that on mainland China. But you're dealing with communities, with people, with all kinds of hearings and so forth, mm-hmm. permitting. What would you tell them?
Well, I think I'll tell them two things. The first is the Chinese culture. And if you look around the world, wherever you travel, whether it's in Italy, in London, right. in Africa, you're going to find a Chinese restaurant.
Good.
Chinese restaurants have evolved. The cuisine is no longer Chinese to some extent.
Right, right.
And they localize.
Right.
The Chinese localized. In fact, the history of Hawaii, I'm fourth generation Chinese, a lot of them have intermarried.
Right.
And so you evolve, your culture evolves. And so I think I'd tell him that first lesson. And I think he would understand that because Chinese food around the world has been localized. Second thing is, let's look at the examples of the local area. I think Kaseko is a good example of a very good corporate citizen who has developed some beautiful land out in Ewa Beach responsibly. They've got a great planned community. And I think all of these things are because, you know, they are trying to be a good corporate citizen. And I think that's what I would tell them, to be a good corporate citizen. And I think the end day, your investment will be much greater than you really envision, because that's part of it. You become part of the community, and they'll give back to you.
Well, we'll go back to this notion of corporate citizenship in Hawaii in just a moment. Taking a break.
Join us at ThinkTech of Hawaii. Our show is Asia in Review. Our next program is on November 17. This is Johnson Choi, your host.
Thank you for watching ThinkTech. I'm Grace Chang, the new host for Global Connections. You can find me here live every Thursday at 1 p.m. where we'll be talking to people around the islands or visiting the islands who are connected in various aspects of global affairs. So please tune in, and aloha, and thanks for watching.
Hey everybody, my name is David Chang, and I'm the new host of a new show, The Art of Thinking Smart. I'm really excited to be able to share with you secrets on giving yourself the smart edge in life. We're gonna have awesome guests and great mentors of mine from the political, military, business, nonprofit, you name it. So it's something for everybody.
And so we are back talking about corporate citizenship in Hawaii for foreign investors, particularly a new one that came to Oahu and saw an opportunity in Kapolei West. And we've been talking to Russ Liu, who's been kind of analyzing this while he's been in Beijing and in Hawaii. And we're talking about about Chinese cuisine and about also supporting the community in many, many ways. And this is where I think the program is going to shift and focus on with these new companies. And so this is not going to be the one and only Chinese company coming or foreign company coming to Hawaii. There's going to be a lot more coming into the future. Some of them are not knowledgeable about the past, what has happened in the past. Of course, and for them to come in and to not listen to the community or promote themselves in a way that would make them good citizens will not be a road to success in the Hawaii economy and society. So we're back at this point, talking about this company that really wants to do good. And they really wants to develop something, a quality project, an integrated one, a mixed use one that is very big here. And so we're going to go into some areas where if they were going to come in, what would make them really stand out? And to the community says, wow, they're great people, and we're proud to have them invest and be part of our society on Oahu. What would one of them be?
Well, there's a Chinese word we call haidzi. Haidzi means children, and the culture in China really does a lot. They do a lot for the children. And I really think being a corporate citizen, the whole concept is alien to many Chinese because, you know, you had government-owned right. companies. And I'll give an example. When Warren Buffett and Bill Gates went to China to talk about philanthropy, all these multi-billionaires showed up just to see them. But they didn't get any...
Right. That's a new product. It's brand new.
It's very, brand new. Yeah, the whole idea of philanthropy, things like that. But when you talk to them in a business term, it's very different because you're in the scrutiny by the media, wherever you go in the West. Everything is transparent. Right. Corporate governance. Right. And there's a part of it that's very different because you're in the spotlight. And that's going to be, are you a good corporate citizen? And again, I think we need to show them that we welcome them, first of all. And I think we understand the similar concept that we have children. Kapolei is an area where young families are growing up, and the whole area, the schools, the university, all of this is dynamic, and this is your investment in the future, you know, and you're having, you know, employees living in that area that's going to work for you. All of this means a lot, and that's the community.
Well, out in Kapolei in West Oahu, UH West Oahu campus is the fastest growing among the 10 campuses in the UH system. And ocean-wide, you know, this may be a good entree, like we were talking before, that they do have an investment in Legend Computer, Lenovo. Now, if they could somehow link with West Oahu to have research in personal computing or mobile or software engineering, and linking it with Fudan University, perhaps, the university, great university that the chairman attended, that's what you say is for the children a jobs kind of creating kind of project.
Ray, I'm going to write that down. Lenovo. We're going to write to the governor. Okay. We're going to tell him we've got to figure a way. Maybe we could have a Lenovo research center.
Good.
I mean, things like this are dynamic. Yeah. And, you know, there's a Chris Lee who has been tied into the University of Film Media School. That's a big thing in China now. And again, at West Oahu, I've actually visited facilities. I'm extremely impressed. The infrastructure is new, but we need to get content. We need to get good content. Right. And going back to somebody like this is something that's not going to only benefit our community, but the Chinese kids, you know. bring them to summer school out here, you know, bring them to do the educational component. And I think the governor is on the right track, actually, promoting education. I mean, that's one of the things that I have never heard of. And, you know, I did meet with his people, and I'm impressed that education is a high priority. And I think education and tourism would be compatible to this being a good corporate citizen. It's not only going to be just our kids, but global citizenship. And I think the whole idea of global citizenship is important because it brings a lot to the community. It brings a lot to Kapolei. And, you know, let's introduce them to football. June Jones, you know, the Kapolei high school team. All of these things, the American culture, a lot of Chinese kids or kids from Asia coming here to see what American life is all about. It's a benefit that goes two ways. So I think it's more than just the community. And when China Oceanwide puts a lot of money into this community, we have a saying, it's Wodaja, it's our home. And this is what we need to focus on. The theme should be in this community, locals alike, investor. This is our home.
So I'm getting a really interesting thing that you don't see the West Kapolei project in isolation, but rather a bridge back to China.
Yes, or in Hawaii, you know, because you have Tokai University out there.
Right, and that's really growing also. But you have a very good point that, you know, Lenovo or Legend is not a small company. They bought the IBM business some years ago. So, and they're into mobile phones. They're into, you know, many, many areas. They're not a tiny startup anymore. Mm-hmm. They're quite a player in the global, you know, high-tech field.
Yes, yes. And, you know, that's an interesting point because, you know, bringing the global component, you know, China Oceanwide has partners, stakes, interests. Right. And I really think that it can be a catalyst to making our home, our community, where the kids learn to be more global, clean investment, really good things, interaction with other global kids so that you learn how to do the business, you learn the culture. And I think this is all part of it that we shouldn't be afraid of. And I think this is how we will rise as a community, you know, through education. And again, I can see that this is a theme that they're making investment, and what can we give back and what can we both share is really an education in our children. And that's our children here locally and children around the world. So Kapolei can be a real global magnet. You know, think of Singapore a global magnet. And kind of, you know, you can dream a little bit, but that's important because you've seen the models created in Asia, Ray, I know you've seen that. And I think that the whole concept is aligned with some of the cultural and philosophical upbringings here.
Well, going back to talking to Chairman Liu, if he was here, what does he represent, or what does his staff? His staff at the top must be very much knowledgeable about the West and banking, investment, and real estate development, and over the years. But how did they develop all this? Did they go training in the Fudan University, or did they go to the West and come back? What are the profile of some of his core lieutenants who are going to execute this project?
I don't know his core lieutenants, but I can tell you, living, working in China for 13 years, I split time between places.
Right.
And a lot of these successful men and women have actually gone overseas, whether it's 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. They've all acquired the cultural understanding, the philosophical understanding, and the education. And this whole thing gives them a different dimension when they go back in their world. They understand what is out there. They understand the rule of law. They understand we have to do things differently. And so I think it's a little bit different. Going back to our earlier part of the show, we talked about Japanese investments,
right,
where I think they didn't have the benefit of the internet. They didn't have a benefit of a lot of the way the Chinese system, you know, English is a required language. So that's why many Chinese could go outside and actually live in the West and understand. So I think coming back to this whole thing of a corporate citizen, I think they can understand that better. And I think we just need to aggressively, not aggressively, but to kind of work with them. Their success is our success. This is our home. These are Asian values. And, you know, our home will keep it clean early. And, you know, this will make your investment better. But at the same time, you know, we want you to be a good corporate citizen.
The reason why I say this is that even though they may have studied abroad and so forth and did work, working on a real estate project in San Francisco or Los Angeles or New York or Houston is different than in Hawaii. this is a small place. We're an island. we've had many issues where we still are struggling with, and a society with Waikiki as an engine of growth, and that's tourism. We still are trying to find other ways of diversifying our economy, and it's been decades still searching. We are looking for affordable housing, for answers to homelessness. Of course, we can't just ask investors solve our problems for us. That's our problems as a society. But I think these are opportunities to kind of let, again, going back that this is not not a place where you can get things done in a time span that is comparable to a Houston or New York, and that the community, you really have to work with the community, or there'll be a lot of issues and so forth. So going back to the foreign investor, I think the Japanese tourism is still big, it's still about 1.6 or 1.8 million a year, and that continues, and so that ecosystem has succeeded in a way. Now we don't see large projects like this anymore by Japanese investors, but still that investment that sustaining a Japanese ecosystem in Waikiki and other parts of the tourism hospitality world has continued with Japanese speakers and people from Japan been living here for 20 years, been part of the community. So I think that's an area where companies like Oceanwide would, I hope, invest in, that they would have people coming over here that would be part of the community.
I think you said an important point, Ray, and that's be part of the community. We need to make sure that we welcome them. We need to make sure that we get them on the East-West Board Center, you know, where they actually are part of the community. And again, it goes back to the Asian concept of relationship. I really think that what sets the pace and apart from other cities, we have to have a relationship. It starts with, everything starts with a relationship. And everything in a relationship is long-term. Relationships mean we trust you, and we're here like your friend, and we're gonna be here long-term. I think that's very important. It's an Asian concept. Not only Chinese, Japanese, but it's very important. That's why the Japanese have been here a long time, because there's been a relationship. And I think that's really important, that that relationship is not only the business community, but the government. And, you know, we really need to work together with the governor, the political people here, the business community leaders, and to develop that relationship.
I think you're quite right. We have to welcome these people because they're putting a lot of money into this. They're taking a lot of risk. But at the same time, they're creating a lot of new jobs for local people, for young people. But there's an opportunity, like you say, there could be synergies for high tech or global, or for young people to really get involved with new types of industries in Hawaii.
Well, let me give you an example. Just following, you know, with the Lenovo connection, I would go back.
And this is the end. We're going to come to the end.
We can talk about next session.
Next session.
I have a plan for that.
Yes. So thank you very much. And we're coming to the end of Global Connectors, all about investment in Hawaii. Thank you again.